Let me first introduce our two mayors, Mayor Ralph Becker from Salt Lake City, up here at the podium, and Mayor Ben McAdams, Salt Lake County Mayor. I'm Palmer DePaulis, and on behalf of Gail Miller and I, we welcome you to this meeting. I have some other introductory recognitions to make. I'd like to recognize some of our legislative members who are here. Representative Sandra Hollins is here somewhere. Yes, thank you for being here. It's okay to clap if you want to. This seems so formal. This seems so formal, and we've always tried to do things informally, so don't let this kind of process intimidate anyone. Representative Rebecca Chavez-Hauck, who is here, please be recognized. Speaker Greg Hughes, I think, is with us, right down here. From county council members, Sam Granato is here. He said hello earlier. Are there other representatives or county council members that are here that I don't have on my list? Okay. Is there? I'm going to the city council now. Lisa Adams is here from the Salt Lake City Council. Council member-elect Derek Jensen is here, I believe. Kitchen. Oh, sorry. Maybe we had another council-elect that I didn't have. Council member Aaron Mendenhall is here. Yes, and most especially, I want to welcome our mayor-elect from Salt Lake City, Jackie Biskupski, who is here. Am I missing anyone? Okay. Again, I want to welcome all of you here for this meeting, and this is a very important, critical meeting today. To further our discussions and arrive at some conclusions, we hope. And I would like to now turn some time over to Mayor McAdams to talk about the collective impact outcomes and help us help frame the meeting. So, Mayor McAdams.
Thank you, Palmer. Just to set the groundwork now, we have this is a joint meeting of the Salt Lake County Collective Impact Committee and the Salt Lake City Facilities Location Committee. And just an update on the work that's been done by the County Collective Impact Committee. And before I go into that, I want to just take a moment to remind us all why we are doing this work. This has been an 11-month, very intensive process to examine the homeless services that are delivered largely by funding through Salt Lake County and the state of Utah, and also private sector and philanthropic support. And that conversation is premised, we talk a lot about data and dollars and the flow of funds and the delivery of services and human beings in our system. And I want to just take a moment to remember that we are talking about human beings. We're talking about families who are in crisis and experiencing homelessness. We're talking about individuals who are struggling to overcome a mental health and manage a mental health issue and overcome substance abuse and move these individuals to stability. That's what this conversation's about, is how can we use the existing system we have today to help people who are in crisis, people who are in need, to move to a position of stability and self-reliance. And so that is the vision that underpins our work. I think many of us here can put names to that data. I certainly can think of people who I know who I would consider personal friends of mine who have or currently find themselves in a situation of homelessness, and we are here to help those people in their moment of crisis. If you don't have somebody like that who motivates your commitment to this work, I encourage you to get to know some of our individuals or families who are experiencing homelessness and get to know them by name so that can underpin our work. The County Collective Impact Committee last month adopted with unanimous support outcomes and indicators that would guide our work in homelessness. So for those who have not participated in the county process, let me take you back 11 months when we started our work. And that started with simple questions like, how are homeless services funded? We know that we have a lot of providers, and how are those services funded? And a process at the county to really map and understand the flow of funds into our homeless services delivery system. What is that system? What are we purchasing with those funds? What is the system as it stands today? What's the current state of our homeless system? What's happening within that system with the dollars that we allocate? And then the third question was, what do we want to see that system deliver at the end of the day? And what we found is while there are many individuals who work incredibly hard to on the front lines to serve people in homelessness, that we didn't have good answers to those three questions. Where are the funds exactly coming from? What are they doing? And where are we trying? What are we trying to achieve with the expenditure of those funds? So, over the past 11 months, through the county's collective impact committee, we've mapped those funds. We understand today that we spend approximately $52 million per year on homeless services. That comes largely from Salt Lake County, about $20 million Salt Lake County. That includes both federal pass-through funds and also county general fund dollars. We have a similar number, roughly same amount, coming from the state of Utah to support homeless services. That's also includes federal pass-through dollars, but also state general fund and other support for homeless services. We have again, roughly similar amount, just slightly less, also coming from the private sector, philanthropy and businesses who will step forward to support our homeless services. Many of those supporters are here today, and thank you for your personal support for these services. What we see is we have a system, and if you haven't seen the presentation that we've developed, we would love to make time to show you this, but a system that in the individual is doing amazing things, and in the individualized services and providers are doing incredible things on the front lines to service our homeless population. These are they're doing a lot on very limited budgets and doing important work. But what we see is that oftentimes that individual Herculean effort is not adding up to a system level outcome. So we spent the last 11 months developing those outcomes that we would like to see from our homeless services delivery, and resulted in a document that is available on our Salt Lake County website that we are meeting with many of you individually, and many of you were involved in crafting that document, but we're asking for alignment that what would happen with these 14 outcomes and indicators. These are the system level outcomes that we want to see from our homeless services. It's not just about people trained for a job, it's about people employed. It's not about just food and shelter, it's about stability. And through that, we've identified outcomes that we would like to see the system deliver, not in the individual, but in the aggregate. With that, we've also identified indicators specific, while the outcomes may be aspirational goals, we have very specific indicators that would be quantifiable and measurable that would help us assess whether we're making progress toward those goals. Where are we? Are we gaining ground or losing ground? Those system level outcomes have been adopted, and now we embark on the next phase, which is in the collective impact approach. We've now adopted our shared system level outcomes that we want to see. And it's now about aligning the efforts that are happening within that system to be mutually supporting activities. Collective impact is more than just cooperation and coordination. It really is aligning every effort that we do within this $52 million system toward achieving our system level goals, toward moving the indicators such that we can see the progress that we're making toward those goals. So those outcomes and indicators have been adopted. To be clear, now what we are looking to do is to take the funding streams that feed into our homeless system see that those funding streams are aligned to the achievement of our system level outcomes. So we are meeting with the respective funders. We've had ongoing support and communication with the state of Utah Workforce Services, but that conversation will also go to the legislature to inform them of the outcomes that we've adopted. We're always seeking input to refine and adapt those outcomes if something may be missing or may need to be tweaked. But with that unanimous support, looking to the legislature to acknowledge those outcomes and recognize that our goal is that all funding that's provided to the homeless system will be aligned with the achievement of the outcomes that we've set for ourselves, system level outcomes, not individual provider goals and individual provider outcomes. We're meeting with private sector entities to encourage their donation and support would be done in alignment with those outcomes and indicators. And we're having remarkable success. We'd like to acknowledge and thank Intermountain Healthcare. I see Mikkel here, who recently, they're a very generous supporter of our homeless services and adopted expectation for grantees that those that the support coming from Intermountain would be aligned with these 14 system level outcomes, and that they would expect some level of metric and accountability to those outcomes as we move forward. So we're looking to align all spending for the delivery of homeless services to align with the outcomes that we've set. And that we believe that by doing so, we can have a system that operates we're doing very well in the individual right now, but in the aggregate to achieve the goals that we've set for ourselves. And that by doing that, we can truly have an impact and make a difference on the people who find themselves in crisis, who find themselves experiencing homelessness, that we can help them move to stability. Now, the top line outcome that we'll be focusing on today, outcome number one of our homeless system is we want a system that is oriented toward individualized populations who, rather than in the aggregate under the label of homeless, individualized populations. And we recognize in our outcomes, 14 outcomes. The first outcome is we recognize 9 individualized populations. The root causes of homelessness are complicated. And consequently, the help that we provide to these populations is also complex. So we recognize 9 individualized populations, and we want a system that is tailored to their individualized needs to help to move them from their position of crisis to stability. So within those 9 populations, we recognize families with children, and there are specific root causes for their homelessness that are different from other populations. We recognize single adults, men and women, and the causes of their homelessness is often different than the families with children. And so a customized, individualized approach to those individuals. We recognize transitional age youth who are aging out of the foster care system, and their needs are different than the other 2 populations. We recognize veterans. We recognize individuals fleeing situations of domestic violence, also very individualized root causes of homelessness and applications and support that are very different. In recognizing these 9 populations, and our first outcome is to orient our system to better serve these populations. And we already have a system to some extent that does that. We know that there is there are domestic violence shelters and support services located throughout the state and throughout Salt Lake County. We know there are facilities for youth transitioning out of foster care that are located throughout the county. We have Salt Lake County has one such facility in Sandy City that's doing incredible work. But as we look to reorient a system toward individualized populations and outcomes, that was a driver for the recommendation that we're going to be making today. So before I turn it over to the next item in the agenda, I want to say that these outcomes and indicators that have been adopted by the county's collective impact organization, in my mind, are the lens through which we will make all future funding decisions as it relates to homelessness. That before we give the approval for funding, and we would ask that our individual private sector donors and other partners would also make the same analysis, to look at it through the lens of the outcomes and indicators that we've set for ourselves, ask us whether a particular investment will advance our progress toward achieving one of these outcomes, and how, and how will we measure that progress? And it's with that goal in mind, that lens through which we're viewing all investments in homelessness collectively, that we've arrived at a recommendation that we will be making today to this joint meeting about an approach to addressing and reorienting our homeless services model to better achieve the outcomes that we've set for ourselves, and particularly to focus on the individualized populations who we are trying to serve in their moment of crisis as we move them to stability and self-reliance. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Palmer. More information about the county's process, if you are not aware of that and would like more information, again, available on our website. Also, Shalene, maybe you can raise your hand. Shalene Gee, who has led on my behalf the county's coordinated, I guess you've all led, but coordinated on behalf of the county, the collective impact process. Shalene is available to go through the data and outcomes and the approach that we're taking for more information. But that is the underpinning of our recommendation today, is how can we make current investments and future investments align with the outcomes that we've set for ourselves and develop a system that is mutually supporting and helping us to make progress towards system-level goals.
Thank you, Mayor. From the city side, in the work that the City Commission has been doing, as many of you know, we have had large group meetings and then small group meetings. The small group meetings have been very valuable because we can sit down across the table with all of the diverse interests that we have on the city side to discuss in detail some of the issues that need to be on the table. So what we'd like to do, and we do this at all of our large group meetings, is bring back to you some of the input that we've received from our last round of small group meetings that occurred several weeks ago. And to talk about the small group discussion summary, I'm going to ask Gail Miller to summarize that for us.
Thank you, Palmer. Is that on? Okay. As has been mentioned, this has been a very large commission, and we've been working in unison in parallel paths with the county. And what's been remarkable to me is that our outcomes have been very similar, and to me that just proves that we're on the right track. We had small group meetings, as Palmer has expressed, with our individual commissioners because we wanted to learn what their individual interests were and bring them together in a unified voice. What we learned from those meetings were some consensus on criteria for success in this process. We had wonderful conversations. Everyone felt that they could bring out their interests and their desires. What was wonderful to me was that as we started, we were all coming from different directions. As we've finished, we've become very unified in our outlook on what it takes to help the homeless population get healing in their lives. There's been a lot of passion, a lot of creativity with each commission member to help individuals become self-sufficient who are experiencing homelessness. We all feel the negative impact of homelessness, not only those who are experiencing it, but those who live in the communities where it happens. And we took all of that into account so that all voices could be heard. As we talked about what could be done to help the homeless, it became very clear that a scattered site approach was the preferred consensus. We did have strong agreement that these scattered sites and service facilities should be made for each homeless subpopulation. So we're in alignment with the county on that. We want to create the best situation for the healing of each subpopulation. So we feel that long-term solutions to prevent homelessness have to involve housing in every community. We need to have emergency and support facilities that can also be found in each community. We want to improve the outcomes for each subpopulation and for all individuals and provide a path forward out of homelessness. We don't feel it's important to crank individuals through the services like in a campus. We feel that each one should be treated as an individual and helped through the system for each need that is applicable to them. We heard about real life experiences, and we felt like the scattered sites model would provide resiliency and scalability to help address the uncertain nature of homelessness. We felt that centralizing the population of homelessness has not been successful, and that by scattering it, it's more we'd be more able to help the individuals as they go through these difficult times. In addition to that, we realized that there already are scattered facilities throughout the community. We need to increase that and build on that so that every community will help bring this problem to a solution. There are conditions for success. Facility siting and the configuration of the sites needs to be tied to achieving collective impact goals. We know that there are transportation options that are essential for scattered sites to work. We have to have increased capacity for detox when we're identifying the top priority services issues. We need to have an intake system where each homeless individual can be accounted for from the first touch until they exit homelessness. We need to be able to expand our personalized case management support. And we have to have increased housing availability, which will continue to reduce the significant need for an emergency shelter. We heard many good suggestions, and we've shared them with the County Collective Impact Process and city staff, and we're encouraged that they have the same alignment with those scenarios. So we would like to thank our commission for the wonderful work they've done, for their ability to hang in there and bring forward scenarios that could be helpful to prevent homelessness and to help those who are in homelessness be healed and get back on their feet. We've learned a lot together, and we've moved to a common understanding of what is needed to help our homeless friends. We do look forward to a consensus recommendation, and we feel that we have strong community support in the process that will help us to site, design, and build these facilities as they're needed to help our homeless friends and have the opportunity for all communities to have input in solving this problem. So thank you very much for all you've done to help in the process. And we know that this is just a beginning, that it's going to take time to make it all happen. And we're looking forward to being able to do some wonderful things.
Thank you, Gail. I just want to acknowledge Representative Becky Edwards, who has just arrived, I think, over here somewhere. There you are. Thank you very much for being here. I also want to recognize John Pierpont, who is the Executive Director of Workforce Services. John has been working hand in glove with the Lieutenant Governor, could not be here this morning. So John, in fact, if you want to come down and sit down here, you're fine where you are, okay? thank you. I also want to summarize the public input that we've received in the last week or so. The city held an open house on Thursday, I believe, and it was well attended. There were about 112 people, maybe even a little more than that, that attended the public open house. There were the three scenarios that we have been talking about were pretty much laid out, and if you attended, you saw how it was laid out. I just wanted to give you some feedback on what that public group seemed to prefer. First of all, there were 65 people who registered their interest in scattered site facilities. There were 38 people that registered their interest in scattered shelters with centralized facilities. And there were 11 people who registered their interest in more of an all-inclusive campus. Some of the comments that we heard from the group that attended that open house, I just want to summarize. These are just little sound bites from some of the comments that they wrote down. Several people said that they preferred not to have the shelter on the west side due to the west side of Salt Lake City, due to the concentration of halfway houses, other services, and now the new prison facility. Others said that it would be a great idea to spread facilities around the county. And I also want to acknowledge our mayor-elect of Salt Lake City has also said that she is very much interested in seeing how we can deal with this whole issue from a countywide perspective, not just the city perspective. Others voiced the interest in scattered sites may be best for individuals, but they wondered about how expensive, what the additional costs would be and how that would be handled. Others said we need to keep people in a centralized, more controlled location for their protection. Others said make sure caseworkers are at each shelter. The emphasis on casework came through. So this is just a little summary of some of the comments that we heard from people. We also held in the city, it's called Open City Hall. There were 330 responses. And of those responses, there were about 174 of the 330 that voiced interest in the scattered site scenario. 62 expressed interest in the scattered sites with some centralized facilities. And 77 people voiced some interest in more of an all-inclusive campus. So you can see how things were breaking down from a public standpoint. And by the way, I just want to again reiterate, as we went through this entire process, we've had another open house earlier on in the process. We've had people wanting to express their views from the public about this. We've had focus groups with the homeless themselves, numerous focus groups, so that we could hear from the homeless individuals on what they saw from their perspective. So we've tried to really make this as open as possible and receive as much input as we could. Some of the comment examples in the Open City Hall session were it would be easier for the homeless to access services if everything is centralized. Other comments, we had some people say they prefer to have the campus, if it's all-inclusive, in a remote area. Others said scattered facilities could be more expensive, but it is less impactful on surrounding neighborhoods. Families should be geographically separated from single homeless population. That, as a matter of fact, became a huge interest in all of our processes when we talked about the interests that people had, whether you were a homeless person, someone in the neighborhood representing business interests, part of the city, just the general public, or in any kind of a helping volunteer community setting, people said safety was their number one priority for everyone. Families then should be geographically separated from the single homeless population. I may have said that twice, I'm not sure. One large campus would turn people into numbers. Let's not let or we want to hear individual voices so that they could be heard. And that was along the lines of what Mayor McAdams said about the subpopulations, that everyone needs to be heard, and this is a complex issue, and we need to tailor services to get people to stability by whatever subpopulation they found themselves in. So that's a little bit of an idea of what kind of public input we've received, and we've taken all of that into account as we've moved forward with trying to bring you a proposal that the commission members from Salt Lake City particularly can voice their support for, and I'm going to turn this back over to Mayor McAdams to talk a little bit more about that proposed recommendation. Mayor?
So this is a proposed recommendation from both Mayor Becker and I to the committees, the respective committees, and we'd like to solicit your input. This is derived from the many conversations we've had both in our working groups and in our respective committees and individual conversations that we believe reflects the approach towards achieving our goals and outcomes. We invite your feedback on these recommendations as we move forward. These recommendations encompass and reflect that our desire to make progress toward achieving the 14 outcomes and measured by the indicators as articulated by the Collective Impact Committee, also incorporates the work done by the Housing Homeless Facility Site Evaluation Committee and criteria for the location and siting of homeless facilities, recognizing that homeless facilities will serve different needs and different populations, and therefore the respective location of those facilities and qualities of that location will differ depending on the services that are provided, but also recognizing that although these two efforts have been happening in parallel and have been highly coordinated, we also recognize that services cannot be divorced from facilities and the location of facilities. A facility is a place where services are provided. And so ultimately, these recommendations and the efforts of these committees had to come together at this point in order to determine location facilities, configuration of facilities in the way that will best help us to serve the populations who are in need, individualized populations in our need, and in a way that it mitigates adverse impacts to the communities where these services are located. And so with that, Mayor Becker and I are going to read a proposed resolution for your consideration, and after going through this, we will open it up for any feedback and concerns from you. Do they have copies of this?
Is there a handout to it?
We have them to pass out. So
they should go to the commission members.
Let's give them to the commission members if we. And while these are being distributed, maybe I'll go through and I'll read the first part, and then Mayor Becker will read the recommendation. So the whereas, and maybe the background for this resolution, and then the recommendations coming from the committee, the therefore resolution. So whereas, number one, the commission's mission is to evaluate and recommend where the siting of homeless service facilities in Salt Lake City should be, guided by three questions. One, should the sites for homeless services in Salt Lake City remain where they are and as they are? Two, should the sites for these services remain where they are but be improved to mitigate persistent and vexing problems experienced by homeless individuals, by residents, by business owners, and by the community? And three, should the sites for these services be relocated? Whereas two, the commission has held public meetings, conducted small group meetings, taken exploratory field trips, invited the public to share their input in town halls, open houses, and through surveys. Whereas three, the commission expresses appreciation for the opportunity to listen to the needs and concerns of those who are experiencing or at risk for homelessness, provide services to those experiencing homelessness, and live, work, visit, receive services, or do business in Salt Lake City. Whereas four, the commission empathizes with the challenges each of these stakeholders face and has careful consideration for these challenges. Whereas five, the commission recognizes that addressing the siting of homeless services facilities in Salt Lake City alone will not help address complex problems of homelessness. Whereas six, the commission therefore has considered the findings of Salt Lake County's Collective Impact on Homelessness Steering Committee and supports the shared outcomes that committee has adopted. Whereas seven, the commission therefore recognizes further that homelessness is a statewide problem and shares a common goal to minimize homelessness in Utah. Mayor Becker.
So I get to give you the resolution clauses here, and I'm going to be making some comments at the end of the meeting in a more general way. Now, therefore, the commission makes the following recommendations about siting of homeless service facilities in Salt Lake City. One, facilities should be designed and operated to meet the distinct needs of priority subpopulations as identified by the Collective Impact on Homelessness Steering Committee. Two, neighborhoods that host facilities should be welcoming and safe for all who live, work, receive services, visit, or do business there. Three, to this end, facilities should be located using a scattered site model involving smaller shelters co-located with support services. While recognizing that some key services supporting the scattered sites may be stationed in a central facility. This model reduces stress on the emergency services system as a whole, on families and individuals who are homeless, and on neighborhoods that host homeless services. Supports the coordinated entry and no wrong door outcomes designed to prevent and reduce homelessness as recommended by the Collective Impact on Homelessness Steering Committee. Ameliorates public safety issues that result from a single point of entry and concentrated services model. For example, the model that currently exists in the Rio Grande area of Salt Lake City. Four, to this end, the concentrated services facility model in the Rio Grande area no longer meets collective needs or shared outcomes and should be changed. Five, the specific configuration of individual facilities with associated support services using this scattered site model should be developed based on the shared outcomes and data findings of the Collective Impact on Homelessness Steering Committee. Six, the specific siting of individual facilities with associated support services in Salt Lake City using this scattered site model should be determined by Salt Lake City. Seven, finally, any service facilities located in either Salt Lake City and Salt Lake County should be coordinated, should be part of a coordinated effort with other cities, counties, and the state of Utah to minimize homelessness statewide by providing effective housing and support services to those experiencing at risk for homelessness, diverting individuals and families in crisis away from emergency shelter whenever possible, using appropriate interventions leading to self-sufficiency, and helping individuals and families at risk for or experiencing homelessness stay in or near their communities of origin. Eight, to this end, the three key priorities for immediate joint implementation with Collective Impact on Homelessness Steering Committee and the state of Utah are A, the development of a separate emergency services facility with associated support services for families and children. B, the development of a coordinated entry system that provides timely access to services across the system with no wrong doors. C, the development of statewide prevention and diversion solutions that reduce the need for emergency shelter altogether among identified subpopulations by providing appropriate housing and support services. So that reflects, I think, the work really of both of these committees, and we want to open this up to our joint steering committee and commissions for discussion, comments, and then I know we'll take it back and bring it to Michelle, to you for potential action. Are you going to facilitate this discussion as well, Michelle? Okay. So let's open it up, if we can, to the... Or Ben and I can, or we can turn it over to the
committee chair. No, we'll let Michelle do it.
Yeah.
But we'd like to hear questions and observations from the commission members in both, in either city or county commissions. But if you would allow me, I know there's two people that I would like to call on first, just to sort of kick it off, if that's all right. And because I'm a college professor, no, a law school professor, so I get to do this. Harris Simmons with Shelter and Homeless, if you have any observations to share.
Sure. Do you want me to come up here?
If we can get these mics to work, it would really help. Is that what it is? Do we have a mic engineer here?
Is that working?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, let me introduce myself. I'm Harris Simmons, and I'm president of Shelter the Homeless Committee, Inc., which is the body that was created 30 years ago to own the homeless shelter, which we all know down on Rio Grande Street. And today owns not only that shelter, but some other permanent housing. And I want to start by just thanking Mayors McAdam and Becker for initiating this review. I think it's obviously really timely and greatly needed in our community. I also want to thank Gail Miller and Palmer DePaulis for their work over the last number of months as we've come, that's brought us to this point. Much has changed in the Rio Grande community, in that neighborhood, over the 30 years since a group of us working with Mayor DePaulis at the time came together to establish a site where individuals and families could be offered shelter and supportive services with the goal of stabilizing them and returning them to a sound footing in their personal lives. And much has been achieved during this time. We've seen some truly incredible people who have made some great advances in serving the homeless population in our community, including a dramatic reduction in chronic homelessness. But at this time, we can do better. The neighborhood has changed, and the population that we're serving has changed over the years. With the support of a generous community, including city, county, and state leaders and legislators, we really can do better. And this scattered site solution with some key centralized services is the right direction to be headed. It's an approach that I'm very supportive of, and I'm confident that the Shelter the Homeless Board, in our capacity as owners of that facility, will want to assist in any way possible as we work to improve our approach to provide services to the homeless community. Providing separate facilities for families and women with children is an especially important objective. But we need to recognize that the hard work really is still ahead of us. As a scattered site solution, will require leadership from, especially from the legislature, I think, in assisting with not only funding, but perhaps most critically, with zoning, because the scattered site solution will require some zoning changes. And I keep thinking of what Senator Russell Long said long ago about taxation. He said, "Don't tax you, don't tax me, tax that fellow behind the tree." And I sense that we'll face some of that kind of challenge as we deal with zoning, and particularly as we address the needs of single men. But we need to have the courage to continue to tackle this problem. I'm really encouraged by the amount of interest and support that we've had from a lot of people in the community as this effort has brought us to this point, and we should continue to capitalize on that and move forward to develop the zoning solutions that will be required to make this work, and the funding solutions as well. And so with that, again, my thanks to all who have spent a lot of time over the last months in helping us to deal with this issue. Thanks.
Okay. Oh, it's working. And the one other person I'd like to ask if you have anything to share is Matt Minkovich with The Road Home.
Thank you, Michelle. And
that mic works better.
Thank you, Michelle, and I'd like to thank all the members of the commission that have worked diligently in developing these alternatives. I'd like to thank the leadership of the commissions, Mrs. Miller, Mr. DePaulis, Mayors Becker and McAdams. We at The Road Home are very supportive of the recommendations that are being proposed. We're open to the possibilities to improving the lives of those whom we have pledged to serve. What I find most encouraging is that you have included housing, because while shelter is incredibly important in providing immediate relief from our frigid winters that we experience here in Salt Lake City and throughout Salt Lake County, and that's something we must never forfeit as we move forward, the ability to bring everyone in from the cold, and I know that we can do that. Housing provides the long-term solution, and also is part, deeply affordable housing, is part of the prevention of people having to turn to shelters in the first place. So I want to applaud you on your efforts and express our agency's support of these recommendations. Thank you.
Hey, thank you. And with that, knowing that we're going to be, after we have conversation, I'm going to be calling for consensus of the city commission members. Any other city or county commission members who have questions or observations that they'd like to make at this point? Yeah. Do you want people to come up? Do you want?
Just a question.
Yes.
Thank you. One of the challenges we saw, and this process, many of you have heard me say this before, but this process from the County Collective Impact Committee, where we embarked on a mapping the genome of homeless services to better understand the drivers that are creating the system, the financial inputs as well, and what's happening in the system as it stands in its current state, and what goals do we want to see achieved. So we, in this process of mapping the genome, And Bryce, the question came from Bryson Garbett of the Pioneer Park Coalition. I believe we've made presentations to the Pioneer Park Coalition, but we will be meeting with you again in your December meeting. But one of the things we saw in the current state of our homeless facilities is that our homeless services are behaving exactly as the system has asked them to do. So, you know, there's criticism about whether there are breakdowns in the system and what's happening in the system. And we've come to the conclusion that our system is performing perfectly according to our expectations. And it may not be perfectly according to our goals and desired outcomes, but it is performing perfectly according to the expectations we've set on the system. That first and foremost being that we have seen that we have a system right now that expects individuals who want to receive homeless services must physically and literally pass through the doors of The Road Home in order to receive those services. And that is placing a lot of burden on The Road Home to be the literal gateway to homeless services. It is no surprise that we have large amounts of queuing outside of the doors of The Road Home because the system expects that. We want a system that is a no wrong door system, that you can go to another service provider, another outlet, and be directed from there to the services you receive. Rather than incentivizing homelessness in a way, we want to take people where we find them and connect them with the services that are going to move them to stability. And we think that the system can work better. So that's the No Wrong Doors approach, that we will work with numerous providers throughout this $52 million system to find people, whatever the door they come in, and connect them to the critical services they need in an individualized approach, not one size fits all, but individualized and tailored to their needs, and help to move them to stability without really, I don't think we consciously made this decision, but that is the decision that our system, that are, those are the expectations our system places on providers, is that the gateway to all homeless services, or most homeless services, the gateway to those services is through the road home. And we think we can alleviate the pressure we place on emergency shelter by accommodating a no wrong door approach.
Any other questions or observations from either city or county commission members?
First of all, I'd like to applaud the leadership up here for listening to everybody, whether they're residents, people experiencing homelessness, employees, visitors. So as the synergy is here, I would really
Can you state your name, please, and just for the record? Yeah.
I'm Forrest McNabb, senior partner of Big D Construction, Pioneer Park Coalition. So one of the things is to grasp this and move forward. Timing, I think, is very paramount in this. Obviously, the fluctuation of homelessness at this time of year, we've seen it in the last few weeks. It's come down. But being able to create something that, is, as the wave starts to come back next year, we're setting it on a path with immediate relief. I know several people here have leases expiring that they're contemplating leaving Salt Lake City and moving elsewhere, whether it's out of state or out of town. And I think we owe that to those people. And I think leave it with the thought that I think has been the forum for all of us is safety and sanitation and cleanliness for those experiencing homelessness. That's huge amongst the visitors and everybody else, but I applaud this commission for moving it forward. Thank you.
Any others? So here and then here.
Yeah, John Wilkes, formerly homeless person, kind of the homeless guy on the Collective Impact Committee. One concern I have with the scattered sites, and I'm wondering if we've looked into these other models from other cities and see how they've handled this, if they've seen this as a problem. And I hate to say this, but unfortunately it's true, is that homeless brings in the predators that create drug problems and crime problems. And I'm wondering how police have handled this, if it's easier to handle way scattered, or you know, if they think it's easier to handle if everyone's all in one place, how the host neighborhoods might be persuaded to see that as less of a problem, and how we're gonna handle that here in the county and in the city.
Chief is here, interim chief.
Good morning and thank you. You know, when we had the opportunity to meet with Gail and Palmer, one of the things that this question came up, and what we find is anytime you have a large gathering of people, much like a jazz game or a University of Utah football game, you have to hire a lot of cops to facilitate those type of events. And so in the homeless area, when we have 800 to 1,200 people down there, it takes a lot of police officers just to facilitate those areas, just to provide that kind of safety. So we think that, excuse me, as you move to the scattered site type model, that it'll take far fewer police officers to have to provide that kind of safety and security.
Good. This is Chief Mike Brown from Salt Lake City.
Pamela Atkinson, community advocate. Last week I'd promised a homeless lady I would bring something to her to the shelter. And Matt, I must say, your services were very quick. I walked into the women's shelter, and I was being checked in just like that, wanded. Your staff were right on the button, and they didn't discriminate against anybody. And I finally said I wasn't there to check in, and I was actually going to go through with the whole thing because I didn't want to embarrass him. He was very kind and very sensitive to it. But as I talk to a lot of my homeless friends down there, I just want to reiterate what Gail has said, and also Mayor McAdams, and that is our homeless friends are on this continuum of homelessness. And I talked to probably about a dozen people, and as I was musing about it as I was going home and realized again and again, there are some people at one end of the continuum who just need a little bit of help. And all the way along the continuum, and of course you get people at the other end of the continuum who have that great sense of entitlement and feel, give, 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 I take, and you deal with everybody when you're working with homeless people. And these facilities, new facilities, are so badly needed, facilities that are conducive to healing. But meanwhile, before buildings can be built at scattered sites, wherever that may be, we have to have the money for treatment centers. We have to have the money to help people with the problems that got them in the first place. And I'm looking at my good friend, Speaker Greg Hughes, in terms of mental illness, drug addiction, alcohol, etc., that we have to have the providers and the facilities to treat people at this stage now rather than waiting for the building. So those are the two things that I wanted to reiterate. Thank you.
I'm Bryson Garbett. I live in Salt Lake City, and I'm a member of the Pioneer Park Coalition, and I served on the Mayor Becker's commission for the location of the homeless services. And I don't want to let this opportunity pass without thanking all those that have come together. It's been an amazing process to see, and to see what has happened in the past 11 months when the right people have come together in the work that they've done. And as Mayor McAdams said at the beginning of this meeting, those that will benefit the most from this are the homeless. The conditions that they're in now and what they have to go through is really hard. And so it's exciting to see, and I look forward, and I'm willing to talk to my representative in the legislature, Gail and Palmer, who have worked so hard, and do all that I can do to convince. And it will take everybody, actually, I think, to help everybody else in the state to see the problems that we have seen in the last 11 months. Thank you very much.
Okay. I'm gonna like do a sweep this way to see if I missed any of the hands. Any other, oh,
Glenn.
Yes.
Yeah, look, Glenn.
But, yeah. I have a couple of points that I'd like to make. One, I see nothing in this recommendation that would prohibit the much-needed low-barrier shelter downtown. We need to have low-barrier shelter downtown. We will have homeless people downtown, and we need to serve them. I also see nothing that says we can't take advantage of the fact that we currently have a facility that's actually zoned for a homeless shelter. Scattered site is great, but we're going to have a whole bunch of NIMBY funds. And we need to take advantage of the resources that we already have. Secondly, I would hate to see the drive towards building many, many shelters take away the opportunity to create more affordable housing. I think Matt spoke to that quite well. We need housing to keep people from becoming homeless. We need housing to get them out of that situation permanently as quickly as possible. So let's not lose the long-term vision over a short-term solution.
Yeah. Glenn, thank you for that. Is this working? Is this one working?
No.
Got it on? Oh, it's working now. Okay, thank you. Glenn, thank you for those comments. And you're certainly right on point. I think it's something that has been discussed, and as you know, because you've been participating extensively,
I'll say all three of those points because they really were three separate points relating to the need for low barrier. I think that's been actually one of the great features of Salt Lake City and Utah's system is that we have provided for everybody. The need for making sure we have a facility that is approved in terms of land use for the city is also, we recognize, crucial for the success. I know we have some council members here who recognize that as well. It's been discussed extensively, I think, both within the city and as part of the facility site commission. And I think you'll see that going forward. And the third point that you made relating to more affordable housing, you've seen what we have been doing in the city. Barring a change in policies, that continuum under 5,000 doors in permanent supportive housing, I don't see that that commitment lessening unless there's a real change in the city's direction.
I would also add, Glenn, thank you. And thank you for you've really rolled up your sleeves on the Collective Impact Committee, and we value that. I think you are absolutely right. That really the place where we're going to make long-term difference is with a focus on affordable housing, and that focus will continue as we move forward. I acknowledge that there are many decisions to be made ahead of us, and there's much work yet to be done. The work of continual improvement in our delivery of homeless services is a never-ending work and will continue, and that process will continue. We look forward to your continued input on that. I've even throughout the course of this conversation been mapping out some questions that I would like to pose to the Collective Impact Committee about those specific things. That there are many different types of homeless services. As I mentioned before, there are domestic violence shelters that are in West Jordan. We have services for youth transitioning out of foster care that are in Sandy and throughout the metro area. And to the extent possible, we like to disperse and isolate those services in a way because we think we can better serve the individuals through that targeted approach. And as my friend John mentioned, it also protects those individuals from some who might prey upon those populations. And that's certainly something that we want to avoid happening. There also is a degree to which we would want to see services that are mutually supporting and be located in a way where that mutual support can happen. I think that the recommendation today is that not be done through a campus model, but through the scattered site model. But I recognize that there's a lot of definition yet to be given to what scattered means for facilities, and that work and those decisions will continue through the Collective Impact Committee and also ongoing conversations with Salt Lake City about the nature and structure of the services and location of facilities.
Yes. Oh, have your hand up. Hi.
Yes, Christian Harrison, Chair of the Downtown Community Council. I would really like to thank Mayors McAdams and Becker, and of course Gail and Palmer for their hard work over the last 11 months. I also want to voice my unbounding support for the scattered site solution. As we've looked at the various options on the table, scattered site has risen to the top as being the most responsive opportunity that we have, and the one that is most agreeable as far as looking to long-term solutions. As has been said before, we face some hurdles with regards to mental health services, Medicaid expansion, affordable housing, and zoning issues. And while we work out the particulars of those issues, the scattered site solution promises to not only alleviate the acute crisis that my neighborhood is experiencing, but also promises to be the way forward once we have those. And I want to thank you all for your vision.
Thank you, Christian. I would just add on that, again, my view is, and I articulated this at the beginning, that the collective impact outcomes and indicators, we've laid the groundwork for a dynamic process. This is, we know that the challenges that we face will change over time, and we want an ability to deliver services that can change along with the challenges that may evolve. Again, I view the collective impact process and the outcomes and indicators in that as the lens through which we will view and make decisions about future investments. So there's a lot of conversations that will happen around the definition of scattered site. And ultimately, what I would like to see us do is to map those conversations back to the outcomes and indicators. Will a particular location help us to achieve one of those outcomes and indicators, or will it frustrate our progress toward achieving one of those outcomes measured by an indicator? That's going to have to be taken on a case-by-case basis, and that's what the Collective Impact Committee will do, is to evaluate any investment against its ability to positively or negatively impact our progress toward our goals. And that process will be ongoing. Those conversations will be ongoing as we look to assess what scattered means, and as we look to determine the location of new facilities and new investments moving forward.
I might just add quickly as well, Christian, thank you, and really to all the members of the commission. It was really been amazing work. When we started, people held very strongly held opinions. I know before I sort of got into this very much, I as well thought I had an approach that I thought would work. But people coming into the commission work had very strongly held opinions about which of the three basic models would work. That is a campus model, single facility, or scattered site model. And over time, as analysis occurred, as folks actually visited and looked at different models in different cities, and as the discussion unfolded, we ended up, as I think, a very strong consensus, and I guess we'll see how that's reflected when Michelle asks for the thumbs up and thumbs down, that for this community, Salt Lake City and environs, that the scattered site model should work best. And it's a reflection, I think, of everyone's good faith effort, both coming into the process, regardless of their preconceived notions of outcomes, that this can work very well. So anyway, Christian, thank you, because I know you and others had particular ideas coming in.
So I've seen three more hands, and then I think I might be ready for four more hands to call for consensus.
Thank you. Again, Representative Rebecca Chavez-Hawk, I want to thank both commissions for their work and for our leaders in both of our jurisdictions in working on this. I have a question and a comment. Is there delineated in this proposal support for capacity building and technical assistance for the different agencies that are going to need to shift kind of the way they've operated? So I want to know a little bit more about that. And then to offer to all of you, for those of us that weren't part of this vetting process, that we're here to help you, help us help you as you move forward. Those of us that are in the legislature, we look forward to providing some of that capacity building support. And whatever needs to be done, want to be in continued conversation with you. So thank you.
Thank you. And I can talk about that a little bit. We are envisioning some capacity building. There are some things happening already in that regard. The county has spent the last year also evaluating and moving forward with a pay for success goal in reducing homelessness. So one of the challenges that we saw as we rolled up our sleeves and started examining the data of our current state is we see that a statistic that was shocking to us, 30% of our homeless population will spend on average 3 months each year in the Salt Lake County Jail. Sheriff Winder knows this very, very well. They are in and out frequently in jail, some for the top 10%, as many as 17 different offenses each year, some of them probably even more than that. So as we saw that data and saw that challenge, we recognized that that's a really complicated population, and the solution and support to those challenges are very complicated. So in the context of structuring that pay for success to reduce recidivism among our homeless population, we are doing some very intense capacity building, working with providers to understand what's happening, what evidence exists nationally that can target and help to support these populations and reduce recidivism. So that is currently happening. We recognize that for that to permeate the entire system, it's going to take time. The other glaring gap in our homeless system that came from our analysis of the current state is that we do very little to prevent homelessness. Most of that $52 million system is oriented to individuals who are currently homeless. Hence, I said instead of no wrong door, we have only one right door today. Homelessness prevention is something that we need to begin to shift our focus. That includes affordable housing, but it's also other homelessness prevention techniques. And we would anticipate that, we're going to talk after the conclusion of this conversation about some of our requests to the legislature, but part of that request to the legislature would be some funding for homelessness prevention. And before we launch a homelessness prevention program, I would envision a very extensive and deep dive into what works, what are our goals, how are we going to target the population we want to serve, and how are we going to measure our progress toward our goals. And that's a rigorous process. It's going to take a lot of capacity building before we jump into that. And we would envision then, if we receive support from the legislature for a homelessness prevention initiative, it would include capacity building and analysis across existing providers before we move forward.
I just wanted to take a minute. Mayor, I appreciate that somewhat segue. My name is Jim Winder. I'm the Salt Lake County Sheriff. I want to applaud the commission. I've worked both on the city and the county commission as we've addressed this issue. And to me, the most important issue is one of philosophy. And it's one that the commission has highlighted here in one way. And I think we're talking about it somewhat from a less than existential perspective. We talk a lot about facilities, we talk a lot about funding, we talk a lot about government service related jargon. As you mentioned, many of these people are in our jail on a regular basis and they suffer from the same philosophical dilemma that the homeless do. And that is that until we recognize that these individuals are human beings and have come from our community and deserve the right to return to our community and be treated as members of our community, and that requires them to live within our communities. It's easy when you take individuals and you place them in one location and forget about them to forget about them. It's much less easy when they are living amongst you, when their children are going to school with your children, when they are working next to you, to allow them to be disconnected. One of the largest problems we have in this community is the inability to realize that these problems are created by us and can only be solved by us. And in my conversations with Ms. Miller, and Mr. DePaulis, and the mayors, I believe firmly that government has finally turned the corner and is beginning to look at this from a human perspective rather than a logistical perspective. 30 years of doing it one way does not mean we have been doing it correctly. So I applaud the commission, and I applaud our community for moving in a new direction. Thank you very much.
In the interest of time, we're going to do one more, and then I'm going to call for consensus.
Thank you, and I want to say thanks to Gail and Palmer, Mayor McAdams, Mayor Becker, everybody who's been serving on the commissions, and everybody who cares enough to be in this room this morning. One of the greatest things I've seen out of this whole process is how we have been unified, and I want to encourage us to stay with that as a community long term. As many of you know, I'm Kathy Bray, Volunteers of America. We have the Homeless Youth Center under construction, and you know that that's a special population, one that's identified through collective impact, and we're halfway through construction, going to open in the spring. And one of my greatest requests, I guess, at this point is that you all stay with us in the operation of that facility, and what we're going to do for youth in our community who find themselves without a place to live. We cannot do that alone as a service provider. This has been an amazing process, and I'm so glad that we've been able to be part of it. I think it's the long-term persistence of all of us together that's going to make a difference. And the homeless youth who have been staying in the shelter at the Road Home this past year will have an alternative and come to us as a special population alternative. and we want your support, need your support, and I encourage us to keep the balance of all of our support and looking at affordable housing, mental health and substance addiction, and special population interventions. Thank you very much, and thank you for your leadership.
So Mayor-elect Biskupski, sorry, would like to say something as well.
Thank you, and thank you everyone for being here. The work that has been going on for nearly a year now is incredible, and it's great to see the speaker here. The state absolutely needs to play their role in this. And as we look at scattered sites, it may be difficult to keep people in their own neighborhoods. If we scatter these out and we break these down into the individual groups we are talking about, these locations need to be along the Wasatch Front in this transit corridor of ours. The city cannot bear this burden alone. It's become way too expensive for our city to endure it alone, nor should we have to. And I hope that as we move forward, we are working together to make sure other counties and other cities have the same burden of some sort, maybe not a burden, but are there to help with the solutions that we are trying to create today. And hopefully as we move forward, we'll see real opportunity to bring other communities into the fold to also lessen any fear around the creation of these shelters, that as we create them and the smaller size of these facilities, we'll see a lot less concern, because as you know, we have multiple entities within Salt Lake City today providing services that are very small entities, and they go seamless in our communities. And I think that's a real solution for us, and we need to make sure we reach out. So thank you for being here.
Have city commission meetings, it's much easier for me because you're all sitting around a table. And this is a little more complicated. So if I could please ask when I'm about to call, let me do my blah, blah first. But if I could have the city commission members stand up so that I can see your thumbs. And just to remind you, our call for consensus, which we've done before, the thumbs up is this is great, this is good. No, I should do it. You're standing already. You can if you like. This is good, and I and the people that I represent, but you can only speak for yourself, really, we'll be working to help to implement the recommendation. Sideways is this is good, and I am willing to help with the implementation. Down is, I guess, you don't think it's good. And since we're getting to the end of the meeting, if unfortunately we see a thumbs down, we'll be coming to you where your suggestions on how the recommendation can be tweaked to meet the interests of everyone, yourself, and all the other interests that have been voiced. So now, city commission members, please. Up. Where do you put your thumbs? Sideways. Sorry. Okay, we've got all ups and one sideways. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you, Michelle. And I want to recognize for our city commission folks how much we've appreciated your help in helping us through this process. So thank you.
Before he winds up and before we turn it back to Mayor Becker, I would like to acknowledge all of the providers who have been a part of this. Through my participation in this commission, I have learned a lot, and what I've learned most is that every provider is an angel, and those who care about the homeless certainly do a wonderful job. As we go forward with this process, I know with their help we can do even better, and I want to thank the whole commission for all of the work they've done.
Thank you. I want to turn time over now to Mayor McAdams, talking a little bit about next steps, and then closing with Mayor Becker.
Thank you. So next step is we will be approaching the legislature for funding. We recognize that our common goal is to reduce homelessness in Utah, that Salt Lake City and Salt Lake County cannot solve the problem alone, but it's the working together. And because we're all in this together, we're asking the governor and the legislature to provide $20 million in one-time public funds, as well as $7 million in ongoing funds. This will be matched by new private investment of approximately $10 million. That's a significant amount of money, we recognize that, but we believe that because we're deciding how to spend it based on outcomes and data and specific goals that we want to achieve, that we will get results. So this proposed $20 million of state funding, paired with local and private funds, will pay to replace our current emergency shelter located in the Rio Grande area of downtown Salt Lake City with several smaller shelters built to better serve individual needs of people experiencing homelessness. Specifically, our priority will be to build separate facilities for homeless families with children and other facilities for homeless single adult men and women. The location and the configuration of these smaller emergency shelter facilities will be done according to the scattered site model rather than the one-size-fits-all emergency shelter that we have today. The location of these facilities will be determined through the process going forward. The scattered site model, we believe, works well for other individuals already right here in Utah. We heard from Kathy Bray about a facility for homeless youth that is a scattered individualized site that works. We also have a shelter for domestic violence victims located in West Jordan, and a home in Sandy for youth who have aged out of the foster care system and are finding their way and getting their feet under them. So in addition to the $20 million, we are also seeking, in addition to the $20 million that we're seeking for the reconfiguration of our emergency shelter needs, we're also seeking an ongoing funding of $7 million. $4 million of that will support the ongoing operations and maintenance and enhanced service operations for the emergency shelter facilities. And additionally, the remaining $3 million will support, as I referenced earlier, a housing prevention and diversion program to help families remain self-sufficient and avoid falling into homelessness to begin with. As part of our ongoing efforts to prevent homelessness, Salt Lake County and Salt Lake City will continue our focus. Glenn, I put this in here for you. We will continue our focus on developing affordable housing options throughout our metro area. Affordable housing options are key to preventing homelessness, to preventing families from falling into homelessness. So that is the next step that we will see is to engage in conversations with our state about their support for that funding request. Mayor Becker.
Thank you. Thank you to everyone who has worked so diligently to this point, both our homelessness service site evaluation committee and the collective impact on homelessness committee. And I want to particularly thank the incredible work that's been done by our co-chairs, Gail Miller and Palmer DePaulis. They have spent hundreds and hundreds, I would venture to say maybe it may approach 1,000 hours of time leading this effort. When I approached the two of them, there was a little bit of reluctance, but as is true to their character and to their commitment on this issue, their condition when they decided to take this on was that they be heavily involved directly every step of the way, and they have more than lived up to that in countless meetings and analysis and visits with people. So thank you both so much. I also want to note, we've had an incredible investment of folks I know from both the city and the county and the state, but let me just mention by name some of our city folks who have put enormous amount of time. Elizabeth Bueller, our coordinator for homelessness, Karen Hale, DJ Baxter,
Jill Love, Mary Delamar Schaefer, Dave Everett, Chief Brown, Bill Evans, as well as our city council members who have not only been tracking but have been providing input, and I know we'll have a lot of work to do going forward. As you've just heard, the in-depth analysis that's been conducted by our community-led commissions has determined that the scattered facilities approach is the best option to get people out of homelessness and, as importantly, prevent them from returning to homelessness. And we've heard so well articulated the reasons the scattered site approach, which was not, as I mentioned earlier, the preferred or even suggested approach by many folks at the beginning of this effort, has certainly proven to be the approach that we think will work here, and it also has supported so well the work of this process and faith and confidence in the process. And Michelle Strobe, thank you so much for your facilitation going way back in the work on this. And I've got to say as well, I'm really pleased to see Mayor-elect Biskupski here today. This represents, I think, the kind of consensus and collaboration we hope for in our community, and I think we are renowned for. And these recommendations, I think we all recognize and has been stated, they need to be carried out and carried out as immediately as possible. We now have an approach before us. If you'll indulge me for just a few minutes, I want to reflect a little bit back from the time I came into office and began working in a very direct way on these issues. When I came into office in 2008, we were experiencing the worst economic downturn since the Great Depression. As we've learned since, but which wasn't entirely apparent at the time, this Great Recession led to a sea change in the numbers and types of people experiencing homelessness. It wasn't just the single chronically homeless men anymore. Families, single women, youths, the elderly all began to experience new forms of homelessness for the first time. And the communities like ours slowly began to realize that our systems and services just weren't set up to work with the changing and more diverse homeless population. So it's important to note today that today's recommendations are the product of many years now of effort to improve the quality of for homeless individuals and to mitigate the impact of the services and the facilities on businesses and residents. I first started on this within my first few months in office by creating Salt Lake Solutions effort to examine how we could address Pioneer Park and the surrounding neighborhood to be improved. The folks who surrounded Pioneer Park and resided in and around Pioneer Park all participated in that. That effort was led by Michelle Strobe for us, and we ended up with some solutions that actually made a significant difference in Pioneer Park that I think it's easy to forget looking back on. I also want to thank those folks who participated with me in quarterly meetings around homelessness. Some of the folks who are here today, most of them, Pamela Atkinson, Lloyd Pendleton, Carrie Stedman, Matt Mikovich, Glenn Bailey, Kathy Bray, Jason Mathis came to many of our meetings. And we came up with a whole series of approaches that made differences in the lives for our homeless facilities friends, as Pamela would always say. We also went to the Council of Governments and asked them to share in the costs of providing for these services and facilities. And they stepped forward in a major way, providing several hundred thousand dollars worth of commitment from other cities and communities across Salt Lake. That made a huge difference in what we were able to do, particularly in the community outreach area, that helped us reach out and provide new opportunities to help our homeless friends. In 2013, a situational assessment was done to look at the long-term health of homeless services, and one of the outcomes of that was the creation of a full-time homeless services coordinator position that Elizabeth Bueller has so capably filled for us in the city and really throughout the region. We also, in 2013, took on the Race to Zero, a campaign to end chronic homelessness for veterans in Salt Lake City, with the collaboration of our housing authorities, the VA, HUD, and local service providers. We became the first city in the country to effectively eliminate homelessness among veterans. It was an amazing achievement that we are called on and looked at as a model across the country in addressing that particular population. And I think it showed us that when the resources and approaches that we know can be successful are invested in, we can be successful in eliminating homelessness effectively in our community. So that, of course, momentum continued in 2014 through a whole series of efforts. We held a workshop for homeless individuals to look specifically at the improvements and make sure their voices were heard. The city set up a Metro Support Bureau that was located in the depot area and began the Homeless Outreach Service Team, or the HOST program, which is, again, pumped tens of thousands of dollars that were not available to the community before to help us address homelessness. Under the direction of Deputy Chief Fred Ross in the police department, the Job A Day program was started that again provided job opportunities on a daily basis for so many of our homeless friends that also provided a community service at the same time. And a six-point strategy came out of that total effort, which also led to the creation of the Homeless Services Site Evaluation Committee. As we have been hurrying, this commission worked incredibly hard through the year with so many meetings. We also initiated this year, really based in large part on what we were seeing around the rest of the country with affordable housing becoming a problem in very successful cities like ours, the 5,000 Doors initiative, which not only was to address ending homelessness, but to make sure that we had affordable housing in our community. And we have far exceeded our goals for the first year of that effort. And it's extremely promising looking going forward. Also this year, we adjusted our policing approach. And I commend Chief Brown and his folks, which altered the deployment of our police and also even to a certain extent their orientation with a particularly intensive effort around the drug dealing issues and diverting those who were addicted to drugs into programs to assist them with their addictions. Thanks really to the work with the City Council as part of the appropriation, started hiring 8 new social workers. So that really, I think, for about the first place in the country, we have brought social workers into the police force so that we recognize the problems for what they are, not as the sheriff indicated so well, that these are not just law enforcement issues. They are just as much issues of people's lives and how to help them get reoriented. And we reoriented a whole variety of other things. So the Place Your Stuff program, and I thank DJ Baxter and the RDA for providing the space and for us providing storage facilities for now more than 250 people every day. And 50 of those folks have graduated now into jobs after housing as an almost direct result of these programs. And in a few days, we'll be installing Portland Luz to help reducing the community concern about bio waste. This is not an issue that is unique, as we know, to Salt Lake City. I was listening to a radio program just last week, and you could have replaced Salt Lake City with a city that was being described in the radio program. We've now had 2 cities in the last couple of months declare a state of emergency around homelessness and the effect it's having in their cities. Every city, I can tell you, every major urban area in the country is facing these same issues. And in a way, we are well ahead of where these other communities are based on the incredible efforts of so many people over so long. And I think the work that we've seen coming this year out of the commission. certainly we have so much more to do in this community and across the region and the state. The work of Mayor McAdams around the collective impact model and process has been a model for us around homelessness, and we're seeing kind of another approach around collective impact to help us reorient it, how to most effectively and efficiently and in an accountable way measure what we're doing and how we do it. And the real solutions, I think, are now before us. The business owners and residents who were obviously so well represented for us on our site evaluation commission, I thank you for what at times was extremely difficult challenges and patience and sticking with us, I think, to get to a point where we have a clear path forward. As has been noted by Mayor-elect Biskupski and others, this is not a Salt Lake City issue. We are renowned around the country and increasingly around the world for a lot of things. Unfortunately, that includes for us, as is mentioned, really true for so many cities around the country. It's also true for the challenges that visitors face and our residents and businesses face, for the impacts on our community from homelessness and all of the attendant and ancillary issues. So addressing this is a state issue. And I want to particularly note Speaker Hughes, who's with us today, has taken a lot of his personal time to understand these issues, to take tours, to visit with our law enforcement and social service folks, to understand the nature of these issues. And I know Speaker Hughes very well, and I know that he came into this with a particular idea about how this was going to get done. We all know him. But I think he's also seen that, we all kind of learn as we experience and see things and learn from each other and analyze things, and that the path we have identified for going forward, I think, gives us the opportunity to again show why Salt Lake City, the county, this region, and this state can and will be a model for a troubling issue and for a challenging issue. And as I turn the hands of my position over to Mayor Biskupski, I wish her very well. There are going to be a lot of challenging issues and decisions to be made in front of us. And it is going to take, as Kathy Bray indicated, us all working together for what now is a common path forward, for us all to make together some very difficult decisions, and be prepared to support each other in those decisions in ways that will allow this community to be successful in what is undoubtedly one of the most challenging current issues we have. And it will be nice if we can say what I would guess is 3 to 5 years from now, that this community has again shown the way for how we can take on challenging issues and be enormously successful with the community working together. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayors McAdams and Becker. Thanks for your support. The political will has always been there, and that's been really the wind underneath our wings. I want to personally thank, and I'll give a moment to Gail to do so as well, our commission members. This has been daunting, and all of you have made such significant contributions. I just want to say thank you, and thank you for giving us the support we needed. Gail?
Well, I think I've expressed my deep gratitude for each member individually and collectively, but I will do that again today. And thank you for the effort that you've made to bring this to a conclusion that will help homelessness be solved in this community and hopefully across the state. And I hope, as it says, that you will stay involved and spread the word that we do need the whole community. We need, in fact, the whole state to be behind this effort. Thank you again for all that you've done to help us do what we've needed to do.
Thank you. And as Gail said, this is the conclusion of one part of the process. It's the beginning of the rest of the process. And so please stay tuned. We have a date for the City Commission to meet again, which is December 17th. I believe the Collective Impact Commission or Steering Committee is going to meet on December 9th. So we're now ending part of this process, but we're beginning some tough work, but that's what our community is about. So thank you, and I look forward to really bringing this to the kind of solution the community deserves.